When we talk about climate change, animals are not often mentioned. The forest biodiversity and its loss are still overlooked. And sometimes it's kind of the last topic of discussions. The most often talk about solutions, well, many things, but also including to plant more and more trees. But this is not per se wrong. What's the point of having more and more trees without the animals within it? What's the point of having forests that is almost empty? For us here, forest is far away. For it to be intact, to deliver us clean air, I think we totally get it. But if one animal disappears in that far forest, I think it makes sense to wonder, why should we even care? So let me bring you all to the jungle of Sulawesi, which is full of unique animals that we cannot find anywhere else in the world. I cannot really blame anyone though, because the nature of this animal, but they are going to extinct, but we barely heard of them. When animals appear when the sun sets, only flying through the darkness, one animal creeps slowly under the shrubs, no sound at all. And one animal creeps through the leaves right up there in the canopy. That's tortoises and quirkus are the example of biodiversity that we are start to lose. They are hunted down to the brink of extinctions for commercially traded to be consumed, to be kept as pet for such a short-term enjoyment without realizing what we are losing in the long term. Animals are the farmers of the forest. Without them, the forest will not function. They will not regenerate and will not optimally store carbon to help us mitigating the climate change. So over time, without these animals dispersing the seeds, fewer and fewer trees to grow to replace the dead ones. And we are start to lose our single foremost of oxygen. And it turns out there are more, like coffee, chocolates, and let's bring the Indonesian most beloved fruit, durian. So what's actually going on? So while farmers are sleeping during the night, the bats came out from the forest or nearby cave to the coffee plantations to eat the insects that are past attacking the coffee beans and leaf. We may not notice, but without these bats, the coffee productions can fall. A study in Mexico shows that in wet seasons, when they did experiments to exclude the bat from the coffee trees, the insect density increased by 80%, and these caused leaf damages, and eventually the coffee productions decreased. So this coffee, how about chocolate? It turns out bats also protect the chocolate trees from the insects. They do it hand in hand with the birds. The bats protect the trees during the nights, while the birds protect the chocolate trees during the day. A research in Central Sulawesi proves that without these animals, the chocolate productions decrease by 30%. Or in simple words, with the birds and the bats, because of their free services, quote unquote, the farmers can save up to 8 million rupiah or close to $700 per hectare per year. So can we imagine, without these birds and bats, the chocolate that we enjoy, their price can increase. So after delving into chocolate, into coffee, let's talk about durian. Still in the darkness, but the largest size of bats, they feed on durian flower nectars. And like bees pollinating flowers, the bats pollinating durian flowers. And these flowers only bloom during the night. So they need animals that are active during the night, which are bats. Because of my combined love toward bats and durian, I studied their relationship in Sulawesi. And I found that the bat visitations to dead flowers are actually key for the durian to develop as a fruit, fruits that we enjoy. And this service can worth up to $100 per hectare per fruiting season, or close to 2 million rupiah. And we have witnessed in many parts of the world, because of the declining populations of natural pollinators, the humans need to do their own pollinations. So let's do some imaginations. These durian flowers only bloom during the night, one night, hundreds of them at the same time. Does it mean that we need at least hundreds of farmers or people climbing up the trees during the night and pollinate the durian flowers one by one? It sounds like mission impossible. And what I share to you was just a services from a few species of bats. We have more than 200 of bat species here in Indonesia, a fifth of the total bat species in the world. And it's not to mention the 800 mammal species. With such number, imagine the diversity of services that they give to us, that perhaps we've been taking it for granted all these times. And they need us because many of them are facing extinctions, or maybe now we realize we need them more. In Indonesia alone, a quarter of the mammal species are actually threatened. Habitat loss and hunting from commercial trade are the two biggest factors. In the islands of Sulawesi, these problems is worse because many of the animals are only on this island. Losing them, meaning losing them completely from the world. And this is what brought me, was from Central Sulawesi, to go back to my islands, working together with my collaborator, Ba'anim, and fascinating young people in the rural and urban sites of Sulawesi. And what we do? Well, many things, but first thing first, we research. The world of Sulawesi animals are still a mystery, but we need this information in order to save them. We need to know how many of them left in the wild, what kind of habitat that they like that we need to protect, and what kind of threats that they're facing that we need to help to find the right solutions. For example, in Banggai, we researched a bat populations on a small island, and we realized that these populations has been declining due to hunting from the people outside the village. So we've worked together with the local youth as the champions to raise awareness and appreciation toward bats among the community. And over time, we built a monthly record and to instill the sense of pride of having these bats on the island. The community say no to the hunters, and we began with 300 bats on that island. It sounds like a lot, but these bats really like to live together, like hundreds of them. Now that island become the safe haven for 30,000 bats. From our success lesson for the bats, we expand our work to protect other unfortunate animals that still need our attention. The forested tortoise that we've seen at the beginning in Palu, all the way to Salibabu at the border of the Philippines and North Sulawesi to protect talaut kuskus. Is a marsupial with a pouch, so like kangaroo, really high in the trees. We realize that science is important, but building the connections with the people is actually key to everlasting conservation efforts. But how about us? What we can do? Like these tortoises, many of the animals are actually being demanded to be traded as pets. So I want to perpetuate that famous song lyric in Indonesia that cinta tak harus memiliki, or love doesn't mean to own. So if we love the animals, I think we should let them thrive in the wild instead of keeping them in our house. So let's revolutionize the true definitions of love. But I think our generations need to be proud because we already have high awareness of climate change. The late survey in 2021 shows that Gen Z and millennials, 70% of us believe that climate change is a crisis caused by human. Previously, wildlife was overlooked, but here we are realizing how important they are to the forest, to our life. So let's bring these animals, this biodiversity into our daily conversations. Of course, when we talk about climate change, but hey, when we enjoy durian, when we eat chocolates or we sip our coffee, that can be way more expensive without those birds and those bats. For those who like science and university, we can collaborate to do research to study the role of wildlife that is still largely unknown in Indonesia. and many can volunteer or donate to a lot of conservation organizations. But I think the more important, whoever we want to be, let's put nature and animals in our heart. So for example, a teacher who teach math not only using apples and oranges all the time as the calculations, but use like number of monkeys in Sumatra or number of tortoises in Sulawesi. And young business owners can ensure that the raw materials are sustainably sourced and not using pesticides that are harmful to birds and bats. Last but not least, I think we should vote for the right person with climate policy in mind and with animals in mind and also in heart. Our generations will make up a considerable percentage of voters in the elections. I think this is times that we need to ask critically whether the candidates out there really reflect the things that we care about. That we care about climate change. Now, I hope we care about biodiversity. And let's be an active advocate for these voiceless animals. Let's save wildlife, let's save the forest, and let's save our future.